At this point, we have a full functional article submission form on our website, which was the primary goal of this chapter. Now, in this video, we're going to go a bit further and add that little bit of extra to the form. We'll be working with some extensions and validation options, and we'll also have a look into what kind of other options you have for letting users add even more data to the articles they will be submitting from your website. Let's get started. In the previous video, we ran through the whole process of submitting a full and complete article on our website. The last thing we did was that we added an article. We added test with image, which has all the things. Now, that's the result we get when a user fills in all the fields in a form. But what happens if you don't fill in any of the fields? Let's test that now. So we'll go back to our submission form here, and we'll scroll straight to the bottom and hit submit. Aha, looks like we've hit an error in the code here. And what does it say? All right, it does not have a name to use for creating the folder in the media section. And since a folder obviously needs a name, it cannot complete the method here, which is why it fails. Now, to get around this issue, we'll be using some extensions. These consist of a couple of methods that will allow us to run a couple of checks before we start creating any new media items. Okay, let's first of all stop our project here. There we go. The extensions we'll be using are already part of the project. You can find them over here in the helpers folder. You might need to include the file in the project before you can use it. So to do that, right-click the file and choose include in project. There we go. Now let's take a quick look at this file. It has a total of 3 methods. The first method here will check for files in an IEnumerable object, which in our case will be the featured image upload field. The second method down here uses the third method to check whether the object or the upload field holds any image. And then the third method down here is used to check whether the files added to the upload field is actually an image. So the method that's used up here in the second method. All right, so let's head back to our control here and locate where we start working on our upload field. And that's right here, featured image privacy. All right, so let's make a bit of room here. Okay, I've prepared a little snippet for this so you don't have to watch me type again. So let me just paste it in here. There we are. So we're gonna wrap all of our code related to the upload field in an if statement. The if statement uses the extensions to make sure that if there are any fields in the upload field, that these are indeed images. And we'll need to make sure that we're referencing our helper methods here. So using article field helpers, let me make sure it's get added. All right, it got added up here in the top. Alrighty. And we also need to close the if statement. So that's all the way down here. Let's move this in a bit. And close the if statement. Great. Now the code in here, all the code related to the upload field, will only execute if an image has been added to the upload field. Okay, let's try it out. Run the project. And head over to our submission form. And down here again, let's hit submit. Ah, another error. Okay, what now? It's a new one, it looks like. This time it's saying that it cannot save content without giving it a name. Okay, that seems reasonable. So let's close our project down again. And we'll run it once more. And this time we'll fill in the name field as the only thing. So our submission form over here. And let's just add a name here. A article test. All right, scroll down and let's hit submit once again. Okay, no errors this time. We're presented with the blank form here, which is what has happened the other times when we've submitted a form and it was successfully completed. Let's check the articles section. Yes, looks like we have our new article here. Great. But then again, we do not want users to be able to submit an article that only has a name, right? And even worse, we do not want them to run into that error we got when we didn't fill in a name. Now, to prevent that, that's where validation comes in. This will give us the opportunity to actually validate the data that comes in before it's submitted and before all of our code in the controller is executed. We'll be adding both server-side and client-side validation. First, let's decide which fields in our form should be required in order to submit an article. So let's head back to Visual Studio. We'll just close this one. There we go. Now, let's start by looking at our article model, where we've already defined some required properties. So it's up here. Yes, we've set the name of the article content, and the author name as being required, which I think looks reasonable for now. You're welcome to set more of these properties as required if you'd like. Now, let's head over to our article form file, which we have here, and we'll add some server-side validation. So now that we've defined which of the properties that should be required, we need to add validation messages to the corresponding field in our form. So we'll start with the field for the article name here, and we'll make a new line, and we'll say HTML validation message for, and we will do like this, and we'll use name. There we go. And then we'll do the same for article content and author name. And I'll just copy paste this one and into article content here. Make sure to update the name and down here for author name as well. And again, update the name. There we go. The final thing we need to do for this server-side validation is that we need to add another if statement to our controller. So let's just find that up here. And then all the way at the beginning of the submit method, so up here, we will add this snippet, which will check whether the data in the model is actually valid. And if it isn't, it will return the current Umbraco page, and we should see our validation messages. All right, now we've added the server-side validation, let's see how that looks. So we'll go to our submission form here and directly to submit. Okay, it jumps right to the top here. And you can see we have some validation messages here, like the name field is required, the article content field is required, and the author name field is required. All right, so that was the server-side validation. Now let's look into adding some client-side validation as well. Let's shut down the project once again. There we are. Now, in order to add client-side validation, we need to add an additional package to our project here. So we'll open the package management tool up here from tools. There we go. And we'll head to the browse tab up here. So here we will search for a package called Microsoft jQuery Unobtrusive. And we'll select the first one here and install it into our project. Click install, and we'll want to install this and accept the license. Okay. Now that the package has been installed, we need to make sure the scripts are referenced in our main template. So let's find that and open that one up. Main template, here we go. And here at the bottom, we will add these two scripts. One for jQuery validate and one for jQuery validate unobtrusive. All right, the final thing we need to do is to add a couple of app settings into our web config. So let's go ahead and open our web config file, and we'll scroll to the bottom of the app settings section down here. And let's make a little room and paste in the two keys. The first one enables the client-side validation, and the second enables the unobtrusive validation as well. Great, that was all we needed for the client-side validation. Now let's make sure we save these two files with the changes and let's go ahead and test it out. And let's go ahead and submit our empty form here once more. All right, looks like we also have client-side validation now. Great. Now that was some option for validation. The next thing we're going to look at is what happens when a form is submitted successfully. So when everything passes the validation and the new article is added to the articles collection. We've already seen that when we submit an article and it completes, we're simply redirected to the same page here, just with all empty fields again. Now, wouldn't it be great if instead of that, we could tell the user that their article has been submitted and perhaps even add a link directly to the articles collection where they can find their new article? So kind of like giving the user some feedback. Let's do that now. So we'll shut down the project. And for this, we'll start in the controller and we'll be working all the way at the bottom here. So after we're saving the article here, we will use temp data to add a success key like this, and we'll set the value of it to true. This means that when the submit method is completed and an article has been created and saved, we will get a valid success key. Now, this key we will use on our article form. So let's head over here and we will wrap the entire thing here in an if statement. So we'll grab all of this here and put it into our if statement. And we can get rid of the at sign here. There we are. All right. And here we'll say that if the success temp data key is null, so that means if it hasn't been set, then we'll show the form here. And then below, we'll add in else statement. So this is what we'll show when an article has been added successfully and the success key is valid. So we'll be adding some feedback for the user here. So we've added the new article has been created successfully, well done. And then a link here to the article collection as well. All right, let's save the file and give it a whirl. So this time let's actually add some content to it. All right, let's submit it. Looks like it was successful as we now get some feedback here instead of the blank form. All right, and let's head over to our article collection just to check. Yes, our new article is right here. Great. Now for the next and final part of this video, let's take a quick look at what other options there are for spicing up our submission form even more with different types of fields and properties. So far, we've only used some text boxes, some text areas, and an upload field. There are many other options that could be used to let the users add even more data to these articles. It could be a drop-down where they choose which category the article would fit into. It could be a checkbox to let the user decide whether they want the author information to show along with the article or not. There are many options, and it's really just up to you how you want to create the form. Now, in order to add any of these many options, you'll need to make changes in four different places. The first place is in the back office of the project. So the properties will first of all need to be added to the article document type, which is what is used to define the data on the article itself. So on the document type here, you can add more properties. And as you can see in the dialog over here, you have a bunch of different properties to choose between. The next step is to add this property to the article model in Visual Studio. So we'll find our article model up here. So just like we did with name and summary, article content and all of these, you'll need to create a new property here as well using the correct object type for the type of the data that will be added. Now the third step is to add a field for it in the submission form. So using an HTML helper, like we've done with the other fields here, you need to add the correct field types to the form. The fourth and final step is to ensure that any data that's entered into this field is also persisted when the form is submitted. This is done from the controller. So, just like we did with the other properties, author name, article content, and so on, we need to use the setValue method using the name of the property on the model and matching it with the corresponding property on the article document type. Now, this might sound like a lot, but it is only those four steps per property and field you want to add. To help you with this process, I'd recommend that you keep the Umbraco documentation close at hand. In the built-in properties section, you can find an article for each of the default properties in Umbraco. And in each of these articles, you will find details about which object type the property returns. You can learn more about the various configuration options. And then finally, here at the bottom, you will also be able to see a sample of how you can set the value of the properties programmatically, just what you need for your controller. And with that, we've now reached the end of this entire chapter about surface controllers and how they can be used to create both content and media programmatically. The final result? A website with a submission form that lets the user add articles with content and images to an article collection. And this is all handled by the same controller, using the media and the content service to interact with the media and the content APIs. On the documentation page for this video, you will find an option to download the completed project that we've built throughout this chapter. You will also find some more details about what was covered in this video, as well as links to the relevant documentation. I hope you've learned a lot from watching these videos, this chapter. My name is Sophie, and it's been great guiding you through the many steps along the way. Thank you so much for watching. Until next time.